Chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. Of Catena Aurea, Gospel of St. Luke, Part 2, by St. Thomas Aquinas. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 16, verses 1 through 7. And he said unto his disciples, There was a certain rich man which had a steward, and the same was accused unto him that he had wasted his goods. And he called him and said unto him, How is it that I hear this of thee? Give an account of thy stewardship, for thou mayest be no longer steward. Then the steward said within himself, What shall I do? For my Lord taketh away from me the stewardship. I cannot dig. To beg I am ashamed. I am resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. So he called every one of his Lord's debtors unto him, and said unto the first, How much owest thou unto my Lord? And he said, 100 measures of oil. And he said unto him, Take thy bill, and sit down quickly, and write 50. Then said he to another, And how much owest thou? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said unto him, Take thy bill, and write 80. Bede, having rebuked in 3 parables those who murmured because he received penitence, our Savior shortly after subjoins a 4th and a 5th on almsgiving and frugality, because it is also the fittest order in preaching that almsgiving should be added after repentance. Hence it follows, And he said unto his disciples, There was a certain rich man. Pseudo-Chrysostom. There is a certain erroneous opinion inherent in mankind, which increases evil and lessens good. It is the feeling that all the good things we possess in the course of our life, we possess as lords over them, and accordingly we seize them as our especial goods. But it is quite the contrary, for we are placed in this life not as lords in our own house, but as guests and strangers, led whether we would not, and at a time we think not of. He who is now rich suddenly becomes a beggar. Therefore, whoever thou art, know thyself to be a dispenser of the things of others, and that the privileges granted thee are for a brief and passing use. Cast away from thy soul the pride of power, and put on the humility and modesty of a steward. Bede. The bailiff is the manager of the farm, therefore he takes his name from the farm. But the steward or director of the household is the overseer of money as well as fruits, and of everything his master possesses. Ambrose. From this we learn, then, that we are not ourselves the masters, but rather the stewards of the property of others. Theophylact. Next, that when we exercise not the management of our wealth according to our Lord's pleasure, but abuse our trust to our own pleasures, we are guilty stewards. Hence it follows, And he was accused to him. Pseudo-Chrysostom. Meanwhile he is taken and thrust out of his stewardship, for it follows, And he called him and said unto him, What is this that I hear of thee? Give an account of thy stewardship, for thou canst be no longer steward. Day after day, by the events which take place, our Lord cries aloud to us the same thing, showing us a man at midday, rejoicing in health, before the evening cold and lifeless, another expiring in the midst of a meal. And in various ways we go out from our stewardship, but the faithful steward, who has confidence concerning his management, desires with Paul to depart and be with Christ. But he whose wishes are on earth is troubled at his departing. Hence it is added of the steward, Then the steward said within himself, What shall I do? For my Lord taketh away from me the stewardship. I cannot dig. To beg I am ashamed. Weakness in action is the fault of a slothful life, for no one would shrink who had been accustomed to apply himself to labor. But if we take the parable allegorically, after our departure hence there is no more time for working. The present life contains the practice of what is commanded, the future consolation. If thou hast done nothing here, in vain then art thou careful for the future, nor wilt thou gain anything by begging. The foolish virgins are an instance of this, who unwisely begged of the wise, but returned empty, for every one puts on his daily life as his inner garment. It is not possible for him to put it off or exchange it with another. But the wicked steward aptly contrived the remission of debts to provide for himself an escape from his misfortunes among his fellow servants. For it follows, I am resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. For as often as a man, perceiving his end approaching, lightens by a kind deed the load of his sins, either by forgiving a debtor his debts, or by giving abundance to the poor, dispensing those things which are his Lord's, he conciliates to himself many friends, who will afford him before the judge a real testimony, not by words, but by the demonstration of good works. Nay, moreover, will provide for him, by their testimony, a resting place of consolation. But nothing is our own, all things are in the power of God. Hence it follows, so he called every one of his Lord's debtors unto him, and said unto the first, How much owest thou unto my Lord? And he said, 100 caskets of oil. Bede. A kadus in Greek is a vessel containing 3 urns. It follows, and he said unto him, Take thy bill, and sit down quickly, and write 50, forgiving him the half. It follows, Then said he to another, And how much owest thou? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. A chorus is made up of 30 bushels. And he said unto him, Take thy bill, and write 80, forgiving him a fifth part. It may be then simply taken as follows, Whosoever relieves the want of a poor man, either by supplying half or a fifth part, will be blessed with the reward of his money. Augustine, or because out of the 100 measures of oil he caused 50 to be written down by the debtors, and of the 100 measures of wheat, 80, the meaning thereof is this, that those things which every Jew performs according to the priests and the Levites should be more attendant in the church of Christ, that whereas they give a tenth, Christians should give a half. As Zacchaeus gave of his goods, or at least by giving 2/10, that is, a fifth, exceeded the payments of the Jews. Verses 8 through 13. And the Lord commanded the unjust steward, because he had done wisely, for the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. And I say unto you, make to yourselves friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, that when ye fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much, and he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. If therefore ye have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if ye have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. Augustine, the steward whom his Lord cast out of his stewardship is nevertheless commended because he provided himself against the future. As it follows, and the Lord commanded the unjust steward, because he had done wisely. We ought not, however, to take the whole for our imitation. For we should never act deceitfully against our Lord, in order that from the fraud itself we may give alms. Origen, but because the Gentiles say that wisdom is a virtue, and define it to be the experience of what is good, evil and indifferent, or the knowledge of what is and what is not to be done, we must consider whether this word signifies many things, or one. Or it is said that God by wisdom prepared the heavens. Now it is plain that wisdom is good, because the Lord by wisdom prepared the heavens. It is said also in Genesis, according to the Septuagint, that the serpent was the wisest animal, wherein he does not make wisdom a virtue, but evil-minded cunning. And it is in this sense that the Lord commended the steward, that he had done wisely, that is, cunningly and evilly. And perhaps the word commended is spoken not in the sense of real commendation, but in a lower sense, as when we speak of a man being commended in slight and indifferent matters. And in a certain measure, clashings and sharpness of wit are admired, by which the power of the mind is drawn out. Augustine, on the other hand, this parable is spoken that we should understand that if the steward who acted deceitfully could be praised by his Lord, how much more they please God who do their works according to his commandment. Origen, the children of this world also are not called wiser, but more prudent than the children of light, and this not absolutely and simply, but in their generation. For it follows, and the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light, etc. Bede, the children of light and the children of this world are spoken of in the same manner as the children of the kingdom and the children of hell. For whatever works a man does, he is also termed their son. Theophylact, by the children of this world, then, he means those whose mind the good things which are on the earth. By the children of light, those who, beholding the divine love, employ themselves with spiritual treasures. But it is found indeed in the management of human affairs that we prudently order our own things and busily set ourselves to work, in order that when we depart we may have a refuge for our life. But when we ought to direct the things of God, we take no forethought for what shall be our lot hereafter. Gregory, in order then that after death they may find something in their own hand, let men before death place their riches in the hands of the poor. Hence it follows, and I say to you, make to yourselves friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, etc. Augustine, that which the Hebrews call mammon, in Latin is riches, as if he said, make to yourselves friends of the riches of unrighteousness. Now some, misunderstanding this, seize upon the things of others, and so give something to the poor, and think that they are doing what is commanded. That interpretation must be corrected into, give alms of your righteous labors, for you will not corrupt Christ your judge. If from the plunder of a poor man you were to give anything to the judge, that he might decide for you, and that judge should decide for you, such is the force of justice, that you would be ill-pleased in yourself. Do not then make to yourself such a god. God is the fountain of justice. Give not your alms, then, from interest and usury. I speak to the faithful to whom we dispense the body of Christ. But if you have such money, it is of evil that you have it. Be no longer doers of evil. Zacchaeus said, half my goods I give to the poor. See how he runs, who runs to make friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, and not to be held guilty from any quarter. He says, if I have taken anything from anyone, I restore fourfold. According to another interpretation, the mammon of unrighteousness are all the riches of the world, whenever they come. For if you seek the true riches, there are some in which Job, when naked, abounded, but he had his heart full towards God. The others are called riches from unrighteousness, because they are not true riches, for they are full of poverty and ever liable to chances. For if they were true riches, they would give you security. Augustine, or the riches of unrighteousness are so called, because they are not riches except to the unrighteous, and such as rest in their hopes and the fullness of their happiness. But when these things are possessed by the righteous, they have indeed so much money, but no riches are theirs, but heavenly and spiritual. Ambrose, or he spoke of the unrighteous mammon, because by the various enticements of riches, covetousness corrupts our hearts, that we may be willing to obey riches. Basil, or if thou hast succeeded to a patrimony, thou receivest what has been amassed by the unrighteous. For in a number of predecessors, someone must needs be found who has unjustly usurped the property of others. But suppose that thy father has not been guilty of exaction. Whence hast thou thy money? If indeed thou answerest, from myself, thou art ignorant of God, not having the knowledge of thy Creator. But if from God, tell me the reason for which thou receivest it. Is not the earth and the fullness thereof the Lord's? If then whatever is ours belongs to our common Lord, so will it also belong to our fellow servant. Theophylact, those then are called riches of unrighteousness, which the Lord has given for the necessities of our brethren and fellow servants, but we spend upon ourselves. It became us then from the beginning to give all things to the poor, but because we have become the stewards of unrighteousness, wickedly retaining what was appointed for the aid of others, we must not surely remain in this cruelty, but distribute to the poor, that we may be received by them into everlasting habitations. For it follows that when ye fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. Gregory, but if through their friendship we obtain everlasting habitations, we ought to calculate that when we give, we rather offer presents to patrons than bestow benefits upon the needy. Augustine, for who are they that shall have everlasting habitations but the saints of God, and who are they that are to be received by them into everlasting habitations, but they who administer to their want, and whatsoever they have need of, gladly supply? They are those little ones of Christ, who have forsaken all that belonged to them and followed him, and whatsoever they have given to the poor, that they may serve God without earthly shackles, and freeing their shoulders from the burdens of the world, might arise them aloft as with wings. Augustine, we must not then understand those by whom we wish to be received into everlasting habitations to be, as it were, debtors of God, seeing that the just and holy are signified in this place, who caused those to enter in, who administered to their necessity of their own worldly goods. Ambrose, or else make to yourselves friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, that by giving to the poor we may purchase the favor of angels and all the saints. Chrysostom, mark also that he said not that they may receive you into their own habitations, for it is not they who receive you. Therefore, when he said, make to yourselves friends, he added, of the mammon of unrighteousness, to show that their friendship will not alone protect us unless good works accompany us. Unless we righteously cast away all riches, unrighteously amassed. The most skillful, then, of all arts is that of almsgiving, for it builds not for us houses of mud, but lays up in store an everlasting life. Now in each of the arts one needs the support of another, but when we ought to show mercy, we need nothing else but the will alone. Cyril, thus then Christ taught those who abound in riches earnestly to love the friendship of the poor, and to have treasure in heaven. But he knew the sloth of the human mind, how that they who court riches bestow no work of charity upon the needy, that to such men there results no profit of spiritual gifts. He shows by obvious examples, adding, he that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much, and he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. Now our Lord opens to us the eye of the heart, explaining what he had said, adding, if therefore ye have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? That which is least, then, is the mammon of unrighteousness, that is, earthly riches, which seem nothing to those that are heavenly wise. I think, then, that a man is faithful in a little, when he imparts aid to those who are bowed down with sorrow. If, then, we have been unfaithful in a little thing, how shall we obtain from hence the true riches, that is, the fruitful gift of divine grace, impressing the image of God on the human soul? But that our Lord's words incline to this meaning is plain from the following. For he says, and if ye have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? Ambrose, riches are foreign to us, because they are something beyond nature. They are not born with us, and they do not pass away with us. But Christ is ours, because he is the life of man. Lastly, he came unto his own. Theophylact, thus then hitherto he has taught us how faithfully we ought to dispose of our wealth. But because the management of our wealth according to God is no otherwise obtained than by the indifference of a mind unaffected towards riches, he adds, no man can serve two masters. Ambrose, not because the Lord is two, but one. For although there are who serve mammon, yet he knoweth no rights of lordship, but has himself placed upon himself a yoke of servitude. There is one Lord, because there is one God, Hence it is evident that the power of the Father and the Son is one, and he assigns a reason, thus saying, for he will either hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Augustine, but these things were not spoken indifferently or at random, for no one, when asked whether he loves the devil, answers that he loves him, but rather that he hates him. But all generally proclaim that they love God. Therefore, either he will hate the one, that is the devil, and love the other, that is God, or he will hold to the one, that is the devil, when he pursues, as it were, temporal wants, and will despise the other, that is God, as when men frequently neglect his threats for their desires, who, because of his goodness, flatter themselves that they will have impunity. Cyril, but the conclusion of the whole discourse is what follows. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. Let us then transfer all our devotions to the one forsaking riches. Bede. Let then the covetous hear this, that we cannot at the same time serve Christ in riches. And yet he said not, who has riches, but who serves riches. For he who is the servant of riches watches them as a servant, but he who has shaken off the yoke of servitude dispenses them as a master. But he who serves mammon verily serves him who is set over those earthly things as the reward of his iniquity, and is called the prince of this world. End of chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. Chapter 16, verses 14 through 21. Of Catena Aurea, Gospel of St. Luke, Part 2, by St. Thomas Aquinas. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Verses 14 through 18. And the Pharisees also, who were covetous, heard all these things, and they derided him. And he said unto them, Ye are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knoweth your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God. The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth into it. And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass away than one tittle of the law to fail. Whoever putteth away his wife and marrieth another committeth adultery, and whosoever marrieth her that is put away from her husband committeth adultery. Bede. Christ had told the Pharisees not to boast of their own righteousness, but to receive penitent sinners, and to redeem their sins by almsgiving. But they derided the preacher of mercy, humility, and frugality. As it is said, and the Pharisees also, who were covetous, heard these things and derided him. It may be for two reasons, either because he commanded what was not sufficiently profitable, or cast blame upon their past superfluous actions. Theophylact. But the Lord, detecting in them a hidden malice, proves that they made a pretense of righteousness. Therefore it is added, and he said unto them, Ye are they which justify yourselves before men. Bede. They justify themselves before men, who despise sinners as in a weak and hopeless condition, but fancy themselves to be perfect and not to need the remedy of almsgiving. But how justly the depth of deadly pride is to be condemned. He sees who enlighten the hidden places of darkness. Hence it follows, but God knoweth your hearts. Theophylact, and therefore ye are an abomination to him because of your arrogance and love of seeking after the praise of men. As he adds, for that which is highly esteemed among men is an abomination in the sight of God. Bede. Now the Pharisees derided our Savior, disputing against covetousness, as if he taught things contrary to the law and the prophets, in which many very rich men are said to have pleased God. But Moses himself promised that the people whom he ruled, if they followed the law, should abound in all earthly goods. These the Lord answers by showing that between the law and the gospel, as in these promises, so also in the commands, there is not the slightest difference. Hence he adds, the law and the prophets were until John. Ambrose, not that the law failed, but that the preaching of the gospel began, for that which is inferior seems to be completed when a better succeeds. Chrysostom, he hereby disposes them readily to believe on him, Because if, as far as John's time, all things were complete, I am he who am to come. For the prophets had not ceased unless I had come. But you will say, how were the prophets until John, since there have been many more prophets in the New than the Old Testament? But he spoke of those prophets who foretold Christ's coming. Eusebius, now the ancient prophets knew the preaching of the kingdom of heaven, but none of them had expressly announced it to the Jewish people, because the Jews, having a childish understanding, were unequal to the preaching of what is infinite. But John first openly preached that the kingdom of heaven was at hand, as well as also the remission of sins by the laver of regeneration. Hence it follows, since that time the kingdom of heaven is preached, and everyone presseth into it. Ambrose, for the law delivered many things according to nature, as being more indulgent to our natural desires, that it might call us to the pursuit of righteousness. Christ breaks through nature as cutting off even our natural pleasures. But therefore we keep under nature, that it should not sink us down to earthly things, but raise us to heavenly. Eusebius, a great struggle befalls men in their ascent to heaven, for that men clothed with mortal flesh should be able to subdue pleasure and every unlawful appetite, desiring to imitate the life of angels, must be compassed with violence. But who that looking upon those who labor earnestly in the service of God, and almost put to death their flesh, will not in reality confess that they do violence to the kingdom of heaven? Augustine, they also do violence to the kingdom of heaven, in that they not only despise all temporal things, but also the tongues of those who desire their doing so. This the evangelist added, when he said that Jesus was derided when he spoke of despising earthly riches. Bede, but lest they should suppose that in his words, the law and the prophets were until John, he preached the destruction of the law or the prophets. He obviates such a notion, saying, and it is easier for heaven and earth to pass than one tittle of the law should fail. For it is written, the fashion of this world passeth away. But of the law, not even the very extreme point of one letter, that is, not even the least things are destitute of spiritual sacraments. And yet the law and the prophets were until John, because that could always be prophesied as about to come, which by the preaching of John it was clear had come. But that which he spoke beforehand concerning the perpetual inviolability of the law, he confirms by one testimony taken therefrom for the sake of example, saying, whosoever putteth away his wife and marrieth another committeth adultery, and whosoever marrieth her that is put away from her husband committeth adultery. That from this one instance they should learn that he came not to destroy but to fulfill the commands of the law. Theophylact, for that to the imperfect the law spoke imperfectly is plain from what he says to the hard hearts of the Jews. If a man hate his wife, let him put her away. Because since they were murderers and rejoiced in blood, they had no pity even upon those who were united to them, so that they slew their sons and daughters for devils. But now there is need of a more perfect doctrine. Wherefore I say that if a man puts away his wife, having no excuse of fornication, he commits adultery, and he who marrieth another commits adultery. Ambrose, but we must first speak, I think, of the law of marriage, that we may afterwards discuss the forbidding of divorce. Some think that all marriage is sanctioned by God, because it is written, whom God hath joined, let not man put asunder. How then does the apostle say, if the unbelieving depart, let him depart? Herein he shows that the marriage of all is not from God, for neither by God's approval are Christians joined with Gentiles. Do not then put away thy wife, lest thou deny God to be the author of thy union. For if others, much more oughtest thou to bear with and correct the behavior of thy wife. And if she is sent away pregnant with children, it is a hard thing to shut out the parent and keep the pledge, so as to add to the parent's disgrace the loss also of filial affection. Harder still if, because of the mother, thou drivest away the children also. wouldst thou suffer in thy lifetime thy children to be under a stepfather, or when the mother was alive to be under a stepmother? How dangerous to expose to error the tender age of a young wife! How wicked to desert in old age one the flower of whose growth thou hast blighted! Suppose that being divorced she does not marry. This also ought to be displeasing to you, to whom, though an adulterer, she keeps her troth. Suppose she marries, her necessity is thy crime, and that which thou supposest marriage is adultery. But to understand it morally, having just before set forth that the kingdom of God is preached, and said that one tittle could not fall from the law, he added, whosoever putteth away his wife, etc. Christ is the husband. Whomsoever then God has brought to his Son, let not persecution sever, nor lust entice, nor philosophy spoil, nor heretics taint, nor Jew seduce. Adulterers are all such as desire to corrupt truth, faith, and wisdom. Verses 19 through 21. There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. Bede. Our Lord had just before advised the making friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, which the Pharisees derided. He next confirms by examples what he had set before them, saying, there was a certain rich man, etc. Chrysostom. There was, not is, because he had passed away as a fleeting shadow. Ambrose. But not all poverty is holy, nor all riches criminal. But as luxury disgraces riches, so does holiness commend poverty. It follows, and he was clothed in purple and fine linen. Bede. Purple, the color of the royal robe, is obtained from seashells, which are scraped with a knife. Byssus is a kind of white and a very fine linen. Gregory. Now if the wearing of fine and precious robes were not a fault, the word of God would never have so carefully expressed this. For no one seeks costly garments, except for vainglory, that he may seem more honorable than others. For no one wishes to be clothed with such, where he cannot be seen by others. Chrysostom. Ashes, dust, and earth, he covered with purple and silk, or ashes, dust, and earth bore upon them silk and purple. As his garments were, so was also his food. Therefore, with us also, as our food is, such let our clothing be. Hence it follows, and he fared sumptuously every day. Gregory. And here we must narrowly watch ourselves, seeing that banquets can scarcely be celebrated blamelessly, for almost always luxury accompanies feasting, and when the body is swallowed up in the delight of refreshing itself, the heart relaxes to empty joys. It follows, and there was a certain beggar named Lazarus. Ambrose. This seems rather a narrative than a parable, since the name is also expressed. Chrysostom. But a parable is that in which an example is given, while the names are omitted. Lazarus is interpreted one who was assisted, for he was poor and the Lord helped him. Cyril. Or else this discourse concerning the rich man and Lazarus was written after a manner of a comparison in a parable, to declare that they who abound in earthly riches, unless they will relieve the necessities of the poor, shall meet with a heavy condemnation. But the tradition of the Jews relates that there was at that time in Jerusalem a certain Lazarus who was afflicted with extreme poverty and sickness, whom our Lord, remembering, introduces him into the example for the sake of adding greater point to his words. Gregory. We must observe also that among the heathen the names of poor men are more likely to be known than of the rich. Now our Lord mentions the name of the poor, but not the name of the rich, because God knows and approves the humble, but not the proud. But that the poor man might be more approved, poverty and sickness were at the same time consuming him, as it follows, who was laid at his gate full of sores. Pseudo-Chrysostom, he lay at his gate for this reason, that the rich might not say, I never saw him, no one told me, for he saw him both going out and returning. The poor is full of sores, and so he might set forth in his own body the cruelty of the rich. Thou seest the death of thy body lying before thy gate, and thou pitiest not. If thou regardest not the commands of God, at least have compassion on thy own estate, and fear lest also thou become such as he. But sickness has some comfort if it receives help. How great then was the punishment in that body, in which with such wounds he remembered not the pain of his sores, but only his hunger, for it follows, desiring to be fed with the crumbs, etc. As if he said, What thou throwest away from thy table, afford for alms, make thy losses gain. Ambrose, but the insolence and pride of the wealthy is manifested afterwards by the clearest tokens, for it follows, and no one gave to him, for so unmindful are they of the condition of mankind, that as if placed above nature, they derive from the wretchedness of the poor an incitement to their own pleasure. They laugh at the destitute, they mock the needy, and rob those whom they ought to pity. Augustine, for the covetousness of the rich is insatiable. It neither fears God nor regards man, bears not a father, keeps not its fealty to a friend, oppresses the widow, attacks the property of a ward. Gregory, moreover, the poor man saw the rich as he went forth surrounded by flatterers, while he himself lay in sickness and want, visited by no one. For that no one came to visit him, the dog's witness, who fearlessly licked his sores. For it follows, moreover the dogs came and licked his sores. Pseudo-Chrysostom, those sores which no man deigned to wash and dress, the beasts tenderly lick. Gregory, by one thing Almighty God displayed two judgments. He permitted Lazarus to lie before the rich man's gate, both that the rich man might increase the vengeance of his condemnation, and the poor man, by his trials, enhance his reward. The one saw daily him on whom he should show mercy, the other that for which he might be approved. End of chapter 16, verses 14 through 21. Chapter 16, verses 22 through 26. Of Catena Aurea, Gospel of St. Luke, Part 2, by St. Thomas Aquinas. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Verses 22 through 26. And it came to pass that the beggar died, and was carried by the angel into Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died, and was buried. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water, and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Pseudo-Chrysostom, we have heard how both fared on earth. Let us see what their condition is among the dead. That which was temporal has passed away, that which follows is eternal. Both died, the one angels receive, the other torments. For it is said, and it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried away by the angels, etc. Those great sufferings are suddenly exchanged for bliss. He is carried after all his labors, because he had fainted, or at least that he might not tire by walking. And he was carried by angels. One angel was not sufficient to carry the poor man, but many come, that they may make a joyful band, each angel rejoicing to touch so great a burden. Gladly do they thus encumber themselves, that so they may bring men to the kingdom of heaven. But he was carried into Abraham's bosom, that he might be embraced and cherished by him. Abraham's bosom is paradise, and the ministering angels carried the poor man and placed him in Abraham's bosom, because though he lay despised, he yet despaired not nor blasphemed, saying, This rich man living in wickedness is happy and suffers no tribulation, but I cannot even get food to supply my wants. Augustine, Now as to your thinking Abraham's bosom to be anything bodily, I am afraid lest you should be thought to treat so weighty a matter rather lightly than seriously, for you could never be guilty of such folly as to suppose the corporeal bosom of one man able to hold so many souls, nay, to use your own words, so many bodies as the angels carry thither, as they did Lazarus. Perhaps you imagine that one soul to have been alone deserved to come into that bosom. If you would not fall into such a childish mistake, you must understand Abraham's bosom to be a retired and hidden resting place where Abraham is, and therefore called Abraham's, not that it is his alone, but because he is the father of many nations, and placed first, that others might imitate his preeminence of faith. Gregory, when the two men were below on earth, that is, the poor and the rich, there was one above who saw into their hearts, and by trials exercised the poor man to glory, by endurance awaited the rich man to punishment. Hence it follows, the rich man also died. Chrysostom, he died then indeed in body, but his soul was dead before, for he did none of the works of the soul. All that warmth which issues from the love of our neighbor had fled, and he was more dead than his body. But no one is spoken of as having ministered to the rich man's burial, as to that of Lazarus, because when he lived pleasantly in the broad road, he had many busy flatterers. When he came to his end, all forsook him, for it simply follows, and was buried in hell. But his soul also, when living, was buried, enshrined in its body as it were in a tomb. Augustine, the burial in hell is the lowest depth of torment, which after this life devours the pride and unmerciful. Pseudo-Basil, hell is a certain common place in the interior of the earth, shaded on all sides and dark, in which there is a kind of opening stretching downward, through which lies the descent of the souls who are condemned to perdition. Pseudo-Chrysostom, or as the prisoners of kings are placed at a distance without, so also hell is somewhere far off without the world, and hence it is called the outer darkness. Theophylact, but some say that hell is the passing from the visible to the invisible, and the unfashioning of the soul. For as long as the soul of the sinner is in the body, it is visible by means of its own operations. But when it flies out of the body, it becomes shapeless. Chrysostom, as it made the poor man's affliction heavier while he lived to lie before the rich man's gate and to behold the prosperity of others, so when the rich man was dead, it added to his desolation, that he lay in hell and saw the happiness of Lazarus, feeling not only by the nature of his own torments, but also by the comparison of Lazarus's honor, his own punishment to be the more intolerable. Hence it follows, but lifting up his eyes, he lifted up his eyes that he might look on him, not despise him, for Lazarus was above, he below. Many angels carried Lazarus. He was seized by endless torments. Therefore, it is not said, being in torment, but torments. For he was wholly in torments. His eyes alone were free, so that he might behold the joy of another. His eyes are allowed to be free, that he may be the more tortured, not having that which another has. The riches of others are the torments of those who are in poverty. Gregory, now if Abraham sat below, the rich man placed in torments would not see him, for they who have followed the path to the heavenly country, when they leave the flesh, are kept back by the gates of hell. Not that punishment smites them as sinners, but that resting in some more remote places. For the intercession of the mediator was not yet come. The guilt of their first fault prevents them from entering the kingdom. Chrysostom, there were many poor righteous men, but he who lay at his door met his sight to add to his woe, for it follows, and Lazarus in his bosom. It may be here observed that all who are offended by us are exposed to our view, but the rich man sees Lazarus not with any other righteous man, but in Abraham's bosom. For Abraham was full of love, but the man is convicted of cruelty. Abraham, sitting before his door, followed after those that passed by, and brought them into his house. The other turned away even them that abode within his gate. Gregory, and this rich man, forsooth, now fixed in his doom, seeks as his patron him to whom in this life he would not show mercy. Theophylact, he does not, however, direct his words to Lazarus, but to Abraham, because he was perhaps ashamed, and thought Lazarus would remember his injuries, but he judged of him from himself. Hence it follows, and he cried out and said, Pseudo Chrysostom, great punishments give forth a great cry. Father Abraham, as if he said, I call thee father by nature, as the son who wasted his living, although by my own fault I have lost thee as a father, have mercy on me. In vain thou workest repentance, when there is no place for repentance. Thy torments drive thee to act the penitent, not the desires of thy soul. He who is in the kingdom of heaven, I know not whether he can have compassion on him who is in hell. The Creator pitieth his creature. There came one physician who was to heal all. Others could not heal. Send Lazarus. Thou errest, wretched man. Abraham cannot send, but he can receive. To dip the tip of his finger in the water. Thou wouldest not deign to look upon Lazarus, and now thou desirest his finger. What thou seekest now, thou oughtest to have done to him when alive. Thou art in want of water, who before despisest delicate food. Mark the conscience of the sinner. He durst not ask for the whole finger. We are instructed also how good it is not to trust in riches. See the rich man in need of the poor, who was before starving. Things are changed, and it is now made known to all who was rich and who was poor. For as in the theatres, when it grows towards evening, and the spectators depart, then going out and laying aside their dresses, they who seemed kings and generals are seen as they really are, the sons of gardeners and fig sellers. So also when death is come, and the spectacle is over, and all the masks of poverty and riches are put off, by their works alone are men judged, which are truly rich, which poor, which are worthy of honor, which of dishonor. Gregory, for that rich man who would not give to the poor man even the scraps of his table, being in hell, came to beg for even the least thing, for he sought for a drop of water, who refused to give a crumb of bread. Basil, but he receives a meet reward, fire and torments of hell, the parched tongue, for the tuneful lyre, wailing for drink, the intense longing for a drop, for curious or wanton spectacles, profound darkness, for busy flattery, the undying worm. Hence it follows, that he may cool my tongue, for I am tormented in the flame. Chrysostom, but not because he was rich was he tormented, but because he was not merciful. Gregory, we may gather from this with what torments he will be punished who robs another, if he is smitten with the condemnation to hell, who does not distribute what is his own. Ambrose, he is tormented also because to the luxurious man it is a punishment to be without his pleasures. Water is also a refreshment to the soul which is set in sorrow. Gregory, but what means it, that when in torments he desires his tongue to be cooled, except that at his feasts, having sinned in talking, now by the justice of retribution, his tongue was in fierce flame, for talkativeness is generally rife at a banquet. Chrysostom, his tongue too had spoken many proud things. Where the sin is, there is the punishment, and because the tongue offended much, it is the more tormented. Chrysostom, or in that he wishes his tongue to be cooled, when he was altogether burning in the flame, that is signified which is written, death and life are in the hands of the tongue, and with the mouth confession is made to salvation, which from pride he did not do, but the tip of the finger means the very least work in which a man is assisted by the Holy Spirit. Augustine, Thou sayest that the members of the soul are here described, and by the eye thou wouldest have the whole head understood, because he was said to lift up his eyes, by the tongue, the jaws, by the finger, the hand. But what is the reason that those names of members, when spoken of God, do not to thy mind imply a body, but when of the soul they do? It is that when spoken of the creature, they are to be taken literally, but when of the Creator, metaphorically and figuratively. Wilt thou then give us bodily wings, seeing that not the Creator, but man, that is, the creature, says, if I take the wings in the morning? Besides, if the rich man had a bodily tongue, because he said, cool my tongue, in us also who live in the flesh, the tongue itself has bodily hands. For it is written, death and life are in the hands of the tongue. Gregory of Nyssa. As the most excellent of mirrors represents an image of the face, just such as the face itself which is opposite to it, a joyful image of that which is joyful, a sorrowful of that which is sorrowful, so also is the just judgment of God adapted to our dispositions. Wherefore the rich man, because he pitied not the poor as he lay at his gate, when he needs mercy for himself, is not heard. For it follows, and Abraham said unto him, Son, etc. Chrysostom, behold the kindness of the patriarch. He calls him son, which may express his tenderness, yet gives no aid to him who had deprived himself of cure. Therefore he says, remember, that is, consider the past, forget not that thou delightest in thy riches, and thou receivest good things in thy life, that is, such as thou thoughtest to be good. Thou couldest not both have triumphed on earth and triumph here. Riches cannot be true, both on earth and below. It follows, and Lazarus likewise evil things. Not that Lazarus thought them evil, but he spoke this according to the opinion of the rich man, who thought poverty and hunger and severe sickness evils. When the heaviness of sickness harasses us, let us think of Lazarus, and joyfully accept evil things in this life. Augustine. All this, then, is said to him because he chose the happiness of the world, and loved no other life but that in which he proudly boasted. But, he says, Lazarus received evil things, because he knew that the perishableness of this life, its labors, sorrows, and sickness, are the penalty of sin. For we all die in Adam, who by transgression was made liable to death. Chrysostom. He says thou receivest good things in thy life, as if thy due, as though he said, if thou hast done any good thing for which a reward might be due, thou hast received all things in that world, living luxuriously, abounding in riches, enjoying the pleasure of prosperous undertakings. But he, if he committed any evil, has received all, afflicted with poverty, hunger, and the depths of wretchedness. And each of you came thither naked. Lazarus indeed of sin, wherefore he receives his consolation. Thou of righteousness, wherefore thou endurest thy inconceivable punishment. And hence it follows, but now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Gregory, whatsoever then ye have well in this world, when ye recollected to have done anything good, be very fearful about it, lest the prosperity granted you be your recompense for the same good. And when ye behold poor men doing anything blamably, fear not, seeing that perhaps those whom the remains of the slightest iniquity defiles, the fire of honesty cleanses. Chrysostom, but you will say, is there no one who shall enjoy pardon, both here and there? This is indeed a hard thing, and among those which are impossible. For should poverty press not, ambition urges, if sickness provoke not, anger inflames, if temptations assail not, corrupt thoughts often overwhelm, it is no slight toil to bridle anger, to check unlawful desires, to subdue the swellings of vainglory, to quell pride or haughtiness, to lead a severe life. He that doeth not these things cannot be saved. Gregory, it may also be answered that evil men receive in this life good things, because they place their whole joy in transitory happiness. But the righteous may indeed have good things here, yet not receive them for reward. Because while they seek better things, that is, eternal, in their judgment whatever good things are present seem by no means good. Chrysostom, but after the mercy of God, we must seek in our own endeavors for hope of salvation, not in numbering fathers or relations or friends, for brother does not deliver brother. And therefore it is added, and besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed. Theophylact, the great gulf signifies the distance of the righteous from sinners. For as their affections were different, so also their abiding places do not slightly differ. Chrysostom, the gulf is said to be fixed, because it cannot be loosened, moved, or shaken. Ambrose, between the rich and the poor, then, there is a great gulf, because after death rewards cannot be changed. Hence it follows, so that they who would pass from hence to you cannot, nor come thence to us. Chrysostom, as if he says, we can see we cannot pass, and we see what we have escaped, you what you have lost. Our joys enhance your torments are joys. Gregory, for as the wicked desire to pass over to the elect, that is, to depart from the pangs of their suffering, so too the afflicted and tormented would the just pass in their mind by compassion and wish to set them free. But the souls of the just, although in the goodness of their nature they feel compassion, after being united to the righteousness of their author, are constrained by such great uprightness as not to be moved with compassion towards the reprobate. Neither then do the unrighteous pass over to the lot of the blessed, because they are bound in everlasting condemnation. Nor can the righteous pass to the reprobate, because, being now made upright by the righteousness of judgment, they in no way pity them from any compassion. Theophylact, you may from this derive an argument against the followers of Origen, who say that since an end is to be placed to punishments, there will be a time when sinners shall be gathered to the righteous and to God. Augustine, for it is shown by the unchangeableness of the divine sentence that no aid of mercy can be rendered to men by the righteous, even though they should wish to give it, by which he reminds us that in this life men should relieve those they can, since hereafter, even if they be well received, they would not be able to give help to those they love. For that which was written, that they may receive you into everlasting habitations, was not said of the proud and unmerciful, but of those who have made to themselves friends by their works of mercy, whom the righteous receive, not as if by their own power benefiting them, but by divine permission. End of chapter 16, verses 22 through 26. Chapter 16, verses 27 through 31. Of Catena Aurea, Gospel of St. Luke, Part 2, by St. Thomas Aquinas. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Verses 27 through 31. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Gregory, when the rich man in flames found that all hope was taken away from him, his mind turns to those relations whom he had left behind. As it is said, then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father Abraham, to send him to my father's house. Augustine, he asked that Lazarus should be sent, because he felt himself unworthy to offer testimony to the truth. And as he had not obtained even to be cooled for a little while, much less does he expect to be set free from hell for the preaching of the truth. Chrysostom, now mark his perverseness. Not even in the midst of his torments does he keep to truth. If Abraham is thy father, how sayest thou, send him to thy father's house? But thou hast not forgotten thy father, for he has been thy ruin. Gregory, the hearts of the wicked are sometimes, by their own punishment, taught the exercise of charity, but in vain, so that they indeed have an especial love to their own, who, while attached to their sins, did not love themselves. Hence it follows, and I have five brethren, that he may testify to them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Ambrose, but it is too late for the rich man to begin to be master, when he has no longer time for learning or teaching. Gregory, and here we must remark what fearful sufferings are heaped upon the rich man in flames, for in addition to his punishment, his knowledge and memory are preserved. He knew Lazarus whom he had despised. He remembered his brethren whom he left. For that sinners in punishment may be still more punished, they both see the glory of those whom they had despised, and are harassed about the punishment of those whom they had unprofitably loved. But to the rich man seeking Lazarus to be sent to them, Abraham immediately answers, as follows. Abraham saith to him, They have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. Chrysostom, as if he said, Thy brethren are not so much thy care as God's, who created them, and appointed them teachers to admonish and urge them. But by Moses and the prophets, he here means the Mosaic and prophetic writings. Ambrose, in this place our Lord most plainly declares the Old Testament to be the ground of faith, thwarting the treachery of the Jews, and precluding the iniquity of heretics. Gregory, but he who had despised the words of God supposed that his followers could not hear them. Hence it is added, and he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went to them from the dead, they would repent. For when he heard the scriptures, he despised them, and thought them fables, and therefore, according to what he had felt himself, he judged the like of his brethren. Gregory of Nyssa, but we are also taught something besides, that the soul of Lazarus is neither anxious about present things, nor looks back to aught that it has left behind. But the rich man, as it were, caught by birdlime, even after death, is held down by his carnal life. For a man who becomes altogether carnal in his heart, not even after he has put off his body, is out of the reach of his passions. Gregory, but soon the rich man is answered in the words of truth. For it follows, and he said unto him, If they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they believe though one rose from the dead. For they who despise the words of the law will find the commands of their Redeemer, who rose from the dead, as they are more sublime, so much the more difficult to fulfill. Chrysostom, but that it is true that he who hears not the Scriptures takes no heed to the dead who rise again, the Jews have testified, who at one time indeed wished to kill Lazarus, but at another laid hands upon the apostles, notwithstanding that some had risen from the dead at the hour of the cross. Observe this also, that every dead man is a servant, but whenever the Scriptures say, the Lord says. Therefore, let it be that dead men should rise again, and an angel descend from heaven. The Scriptures are more worthy of credit than all. For the Lord of angels, the Lord as well of the living and the dead, is their author. But if God knew this, that the dead rising again profited the living, he would not have omitted it, seeing that he disposes all things for our advantage. Again, if the dead were often to rise again, this too would in time be disregarded. And the devil also would easily insinuate perverse doctrines, devising resurrection also by means of his own instruments, not indeed really rising up the deceased, but by certain delusions deceiving the sight of the beholders, or contriving, that is, setting up some to pretend death. Augustine, but someone may say, if the dead have no care for the living, how did the rich man ask Abraham that he should send Lazarus to his five brethren? But because he said this, did the rich man therefore know what his brethren were doing, or what was their condition at that time? His care about the living was such that he might yet be altogether ignorant what they were doing, just as we care about the dead, although we know nothing of what they do. But again the question occurs, how did Abraham know that Moses and the prophets are here in their books? Whence also had he known that the rich man had lived in luxury, but Lazarus in affliction. Not surely when these things were going on in their lifetime, but at their death he might know through Lazarus' telling him, that in order that might not be false, which the prophet says, Abraham heard us not. The dead might also hear something from the angels who are ever present at the things which are done here. They might also know some things which it were necessary for them to have known, not only past but also future, through the revelation of the Church of God. Augustine, but these things may be so taken in allegory, that by the rich man we understand the proud Jews, ignorant of the righteousness of God, and going about to establish their own. The purple and fine linen are the grandeur of the kingdom, and the kingdom of God, he says, shall be taken away from you. The sumptuous feasting is the boasting of the law, in which they gloried, rather abusing it to swell their pride than using it as the necessary means of salvation. But the beggar, by name Lazarus, which is interpreted assisted, signifies want, as for instance some Gentile or publican, who is all the more relieved, as he presumes less on the abundance of his resources. Gregory, Lazarus, then full of sores, figuratively represents the Gentile people, who, when turned to God, were not ashamed to confess their sins. Their wound was in the skin. For what is confession of sins, but a certain bursting forth of wounds? But Lazarus, full of wounds, desired to be fed by the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table, and no more gave to him, because that proud people disdained to admit any Gentile to the knowledge of the law. The words flowed down to him from knowledge, as the crumbs fell from the table. Augustine, but the dogs which licked the poor man's sores are those most wicked men who love sin, who with their large tongue cease not to praise the evil works, which another loathes, groaning in himself and confessing. Gregory, sometimes also in the Holy Word by dogs are understood preachers, according to that the tongue of the dogs may be red by the very blood of thy enemies. For the tongue of dogs, while it licks the wound, heals it. For holy teachers, when they instruct us in confession of sin, touch as it were by the tongue of the soul's wound. The rich man was buried in hell, but Lazarus was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom. That is, into that secret rest of which the truth says, many shall come from the east and the west, and shall lie down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast into utter darkness. But being afar off, the rich man lifted up his eyes to behold Lazarus, because the unbelievers, while they suffer the sentence of their condemnation, lying in the deep, fix their eyes upon certain of the faithful, abiding before the day of the last judgment, and rest above them, whose bliss afterwards they would in no wise contemplate. But that which they behold is afar off, for thither they cannot attain by their merits. But he is described to burn chiefly in his tongue, because the unbelieving people held in their mouth the word of God, which in their deeds they despised to keep. In that part, then, a man will have most burning, wherein he most of all shows he knew that which he refused to do. Now Abraham calls him his son, whom at the same time he delivers not from torments, because the fathers of this unbelieving people observe that many have gone aside from their faith, are not moved with any compassion to rescue them from torments, whom nevertheless they recognize as sons. Augustine, by the five brothers whom he says he has in his father's house, he means the Jews who were called five, because they were bound under the law, which was given by Moses, who wrote five books. Chrysostom, or he had five brothers, that is, the five senses to which he was before a slave, and therefore he could not love Lazarus, because his brethren loved not poverty. Those brethren have sent thee into these torments. They cannot be saved unless they die. Otherwise, it must needs be that the brethren dwell with their brother. But why seekest thou that I should send Lazarus? They have Moses and the prophets. Moses was the poor Lazarus, who counted the poverty of Christ greater than the riches of Pharaoh. Jeremiah, cast into the dungeon, was fed on the bread of affliction, and all the prophets teach those brethren. But those brethren cannot be saved unless someone rise from the dead. For those brethren, before Christ was risen, brought me to death. He is dead. But those brethren have risen again. For my eye sees Christ, my ear hears him, my hands handle him. From that we have said then, we determine the fit place for Marcion and Manichaeus, who destroy the Old Testament. See what Abraham says, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, as though he said, Thou doest well by expecting him who is to rise again. But in them Christ speaks, If thou wilt hear them, thou wilt hear him also. Gregory, but the Jewish people, because they disdained to spiritually understand the words of Moses, did not come to him of whom Moses had spoken. Ambrose, or else Lazarus is poor in this world, but rich to God, for not all poverty is holy, nor all riches vile, but as luxury disgraces riches, so holiness commends poverty. Or is there any apostolic man, poor in speech, but rich in faith, who keeps the true faith, requiring not the appendage of words? To such a one I liken him who ofttimes, beaten by the Jews, offered the wounds of his body, to be licked as it were by certain dogs. Blessed dogs unto whom the dropping from such wounds so falls as to fill the heart and mouth of those whose office it is to guard the house, preserve the flock, keep off the wolf. And because the word is bread, our faith is of the word. The crumbs are, as it were, certain doctrines of the faith, that is to say, the mysteries of the Scriptures. But the Arians who court the alliance of regal power, that they may assail the truth of the Church, do not they seem to you to be in purple and fine linen? And these, when they defend the counterfeit instead of the truth, abound in flowing discourses. Rich heresy has composed many gospels, and poor faith has kept this single gospel, which it had received. Rich philosophy has made itself many gods. The poor church has known only one. Do not those riches seem to you to be poor, and that poverty to be rich? Augustine, again also, that story may be understood, so that we may take Lazarus to mean our Lord, lying at the gate of the rich man, because he condescended to the proud ears of the Jews in the lowliness of his incarnation, desiring to be fed from the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table, that is, seeking from them even the least works of righteousness, which, through pride, they would not use for their own table, that is, their own power, which works, although very slight and without discipline of perseverance in a good life, sometimes at least they might do by chance, as crumbs frequently fall from the table. The wounds are the sufferings of our Lord. The dogs who licked them are the Gentiles, whom the Jews called unclean. And yet, with the sweetest odor of devotion, they lick the suffering of our Lord in the sacraments of his body and blood throughout the whole world. Abraham's bosom is understood to be the hiding place of the Father, whither after his passion our Lord, rising again, was taken up, whither he said to be carried by the angels, as it seems to me, because that reception by which Christ reached the Father's secret place, the angels announced to the disciples. The rest may be taken according to the former explanation, because that is well understood to be the Father's secret place, where even before the resurrection the souls of the righteous live with God. End of chapter 16.